We'll move on to Reva, who's batch of 1985. She's a graduate in forensic science and very modest about this, but done a lot to make forensic science become accepted as a science in the city of Bombay and as a course at Xavier's. She's created this consultancy firm called FACTS, in which she has advised local law enforcement agencies and provided training consultancy to professional and educational institutions. She's very passionate about what she does, and her talk is going to be forensics, protect the innocent, punish the guilty. So on to Reva.
Good evening. That was a wicked start, fashion, beautiful, and now we go to the ugly side of the world. I'm going to start by telling you a little story where conventional forensics and probably your understanding of forensic science is applicable. Raj Agarwal was a little 11-year-old boy who was kidnapped on his way cycling to school in Sion. This was many years ago. His body was never recovered despite numerous ransom phone calls, a ransom being provided, immense law enforcement intervention. The body was never recovered. Many years later, in a faraway place, Dound, to be precise, in a well that was empty, a skeleton was recovered. And through communication between police stations, they were able to narrow down to the possibility that this could be Raj Agarwal's body. It was completely skeletonized and decomposed. And forensics was able to assist in this particular case tremendously because there was opportunity to utilize the current technologies. I'm just briefly going to get into what was done. DNA was the primary force, which was used to identify the remains based on the genetic material in the remains, the skeletal remains, being compared to the parents. They knew who the parents were. There were a few interesting fallbacks from that, in that one of the parents turned out not to be the actual parent of this skeleton. And of course, defense used this to their strength. Facial reconstruction was also used because they had to reconstruct this child's face to establish that it was the identity of the child. And finally, forensic dentistry, which was one of the cruxes of actually corroborating the evidence, because this child wore braces and the braces were still on the skeleton. Now, this is an ugly start. I'm just trying to show you that forensics does play a significant role in crime investigation. So what is this forensics that we talk about? Today we are applying our science, our own principles in law, both in the criminal side as well as the civil side. And some of the criminal cases I've identified here, some civil cases which you may not be aware of where our science is applied. Today, white-collar crime and the civil situation is far more worrisome than conventional crime. Conventional crime has now started to take a backseat, and even for us as forensic scientists, fingerprint analysis, bite mark analysis, these are all taking a backseat to digital evidence analysis, document analysis, which is coming into the forefront. However, I think it's important for you to understand as an audience, and for you, the future forensic scientists or lawyers, that we are only part of a very big pie. We work as a team, and we just corroborate what is established by law enforcement. However, our role is critical, especially when there is weightage on scientific evidence, as you saw in the Raj Agarwal case. So who works together? The forensic scientists and the medical officers will work together to work on evidence as well as the person, like in the Raj Agarwal case. We work, interact closely with the police forces and other law enforcement agencies that are doing the actual groundwork or investigation. And finally, together we present the picture or the reconstruction to the courts through the lawyers. Unfortunately, today, with media, we're battling a huge base knowledge, but an erroneous base knowledge. Media has hyped forensics to the extent where today we're battling people expecting DNA results within 3 hours, because that's what CSI does. We should know the answers of why the person shot his sister, because that's what CID tells us we should know. We're limited to our science. So we're facing a lot of conflict, a lot of issues where people need to come together. I was just talking to Laila Baba Adam about the media not reporting accurately what they see, sensationalizing titles, putting an impression in the public eye of something quite different to what the actual truth is, makes our job much harder. Trial by media, judgment by media. So what is the onus? The onus is to punish the guilty if proven guilty, or to exonerate the innocent if proven innocent. Today, I'm going to shift away from the obvious of punish the guilty, and I'm going to focus on the innocent, which is what the title of my talk is, The Innocence Project, because I feel very strongly and passionately about this, both as a human being and as a forensic scientist. And I hope by the end of today, you will also understand this particular worrisome aspect. Collectively, the law enforcement agencies, the experts, which would be the scientific experts, and the judiciary would create the verdict guilty or innocent, and therefore exoneration. Some of the crime statistics in India, and I've promised Monisha I won't spend too much time on this slide. This is essentially just to bring to notice something that is a little concerning, and that is that we have high crime rates, but we have very low conviction rates. Comparatively low conviction rates. Now, we can have another whole talk on why this happens, but what I want to point out is if we have low conviction rates, we need to understand as a society there is a desire to convict the guilty. And therefore, in that desire, in that need to push the statistics up, we can make mistakes. And that is just unacceptable. There is a saying that you'd rather let one guilty person go than convict one innocent person. The Innocence Project is a project that has been undertaken in the United States. In 1992, this project was set up by lawyers who had worked the O.J. Simpson trial. And you're more than welcome, students, to Google this or contact me, and I can give you further information on any of these subjects. So this Innocence Project was set up primarily to ensure that they gave a voice to people who were innocent but convicted and behind bars. Now, interestingly enough, the statistics of conversion is quite high. 1992 to 2012, we're looking at 10 years. And in 10 years, there have been 301 people whose judgments had to be overturned. That is, 301 people were convicted of crimes they did not commit. Out of these 301 people, 18 were on death row. The reason I'm talking about the Innocence Project is because America has the facility to do this. They have the infrastructure. But unfortunately, in our system, due to lack of funding, due to lack of awareness, we don't have the availability of such a system, such a structure. And therefore, it becomes even more worrisome as a citizen of this country, as a person with constitutional rights, fundamental rights. I would just like to share with you some statistics from the Innocence Project, and that is that most people who petition the Innocence Project team and ask for their case to be re-examined are focusing on the DNA evidence. A lot of the convictions that took place prior to DNA coming into the scientific forum, into the legal forum. These were the days when we thought fingerprints were infallible, when we thought that if you found if somebody committed a crime and confessed to it, then the confession was 100% valid. We did not have the technological know-how. This is something that forensics and most scientific fields will face continuously. Technology changes, it gets better, and what we did not know earlier, now we know and we can use. So they've used DNA technology to go back and look at cases where there was DNA evidence. For those of you who are uncomfortable with what the DNA evidence is, basically, our entire bodies contain cells, and cells contain DNA. And if you take that DNA from any part of your body and examine it, it's going to be identical to all parts of your body, and therefore can be used as a biological connection to your parents, as a biological connection from you to any place that you've touched, wherever you've left your hair, wherever you've left fingerprints and sweat, wherever you may have drunk a glass of water and left saliva, cells, DNA will connect you. So that's how we play a role. We use it for connection. Now, How did the Innocence Project take place? Essentially what they did was they went back and looked at these crimes and looked at the evidences that were stored, mandatorily stored, and worked out whether the biological state of the evidence was intact. And if it was, could they now take it and use new DNA technology, analyzing that same hair sample, skin sample, blood sample that was found at the crime scene. If the DNA was intact, then they were able to type it, and sometimes, 301 times, they found that the DNA did not match the accused. So the DNA from the crime scene checked against the accused DNA, no match. Therefore, you've made a wrong connection. At that point, there could be various reasons why that connection was made, and we're going to get into that in a couple of minutes. I just want to establish that that connection was incorrect. Now, average sentence served is 13 years, which means somebody's been incarcerated for 13 years on average before this discovery takes place. What is fantastic, again, because they have the infrastructure, is the United States is able to rehabilitate them. They are given financial compensation when they come out, and they're reestablished in society. What happens to the actual perpetrator of the crime? In 40% of the cases, the Innocence Project establishes that the actual perpetrator does get found. And that is because they have strong DNA databases, which they can then utilize to establish who the real perpetrator is. Again, something we're shortfall in this country. We don't have strong DNA databases. Actually, we don't have DNA databases. The project has failed in 22%. It would only be accurate for me to tell you how many times they have not been able to succeed, having given you 301 success stories. We say 22% have not succeeded. I have had the opportunity to work closely in this case with the accused. Some of you may be a bit surprised to hear, but on the side of the defense. Okay, this particular case, you may recall, is a recent case, a serial killing of little children. And the perpetrator was identified as Javed Ahmed Sheikh. He is 19 years old, and he was a cable network linesman. He was charged with rape and homicide of these three children, and he was convicted. We helped in his defense based on the scientific evidence that was provided. Now, I'd share with you some of the prosecution arguments. Witness testimony. Our country relies very heavily, our judicial system relies very heavily on witness statements that are made. Witness statements are not infallible. The DNA of the accused matched the DNA recovered from the three victims. Garments of the accused had blood stains and semen stains on them, which were matched to the victim, to the accused, my apologies, to the accused. And finally, there were wires used to bind the third victim. And these wires were established to be identical to wire rolls that were found on the accused. Okay? I'm just going to point out some of the questions that we considered in the courtroom as part of the defense strategy. I am not going to share my personal opinion. This is just purely on science. I will discuss the personal opinion at a later stage if anybody wants to individually. Witness testimony, counter it. How reliable is the witness testimony? We've seen several cases in the media where witnesses have withdrawn their statements. They have changed their opinion on identification. So an issue here. Shoddy investigation. The DNA samples that were provided for match were in decomposed state. So scientifically, biologically, not comparable. But we were able to compare them in the labs, in the local labs, and establish a match. The DNA that was recovered from the accused was recovered under pressure, was recovered under forced means. So where was that DNA originally present on the victim? The stains on the garments were not consistent with patterns of what could have happened or what really did happen. And the wires, we all know that you can buy bundles of wires in any electric store and they will be consistent. They're a mass manufactured product. So just because you have wires in your house, does that make you guilty? Some of the problem areas quickly. We put a lot of onus on the eyewitness testimony. We have erroneous identification parades. A lot of people will show up and say, yes, that's the one and I saw it. I saw him there, he was there, he was on that roof, it was him. False confessions that are taken under duress. and our role, false and misleading scientific evidence. Very often our evidence, if not put in context or not given with error limits, can be misinterpreted. And this is where we talk about the media intervention. And finally, the judiciary is not equipped to evaluate the strength of the forensic science, and therefore one has to focus on how to do something about that. I'm quickly going to just go through some of the recommendations. The purpose of this presentation was essentially to bring to you another aspect of forensic science, which is the fact that today you could be an innocent person convicted of a crime that you did not commit. What is your judicial recourse? What is your legal recourse? What we can do to strengthen the system is basic education, awareness of our own rights, prevalence of logic by asking a lot of questions that need answers, and of course, advocacy for change in an overburdened judicial system. So if I leave you with, protect yourself, you could be the next innocent victim of a poor justice system. Thank you.
We can take a question because we have 5 minutes. Would anybody like to ask a question on this? No?
Thank you, that was very interesting. I wondered if you could maybe share with us what drove you to this, to forensic science and studying it and then making it a career.
I was a diehard medical student. I wanted medicine more than anything I knew, and I didn't make it. So I looked for something that was as close as possible to medicine and decided that if it wasn't going to be live bodies, then it would be dead bodies. That sounds terrible, but that was the truth.
Thank
I think
you.
Being here with the freedom that we had, where you didn't feel embarrassed by saying this, and I'm not embarrassed saying this out in BIS, that's what drove me. Okay.
Wonderful. And thank you for your question because it added a personal touch. And thank you, Reeva, for giving this very dispassionate and very clear idea of how you apply science to law.